Hello everyone. In this video, we are going to look at efficient surveys and surveillance in emergencies. Surveillance is the monitoring of behavior, activities, and other changing information that is usually of people for the purpose of influencing, managing, directing, or protecting them. A surveillance system is built upon the systematic gathering of information on communities and groups of people. And this can be done through surveys, data sets, and all other research and information sources. Disease surveillance. We have several types of surveillance, and among them we are going to talk about disease surveillance and nutrition surveillance. Disease surveillance is an information-based activity that involves the collection, analysis, and interpretation of large volumes of data originating from a variety of sources. And the information that is usually collected is used in a number of ways in order to evaluate the effectiveness of control and preventive health measures. Disease surveillance is an epidemiological practice by which the spread of disease is monitored in order to establish patterns of progress, such as exercise of continuous scrutiny and watchfulness over distribution of disease and related factors. These are some of the key activities carried out during a disease surveillance. What is the role of disease surveillance? The main role of disease surveillance is to predict, observe, and minimize the harm caused by outbreak, epidemic, and pandemic situations. To also increase the knowledge about which factors may contribute to such circumstances, and inform policies and actions or decision-making so as to address health and disease in the population. Then the key part of modern disease surveillance is the practice of disease case reporting. This is one of the major activities carried out during disease surveillance. Active reporting of cases of various diseases. And then we also have what we call nutrition surveillance. And this is an ongoing system for generating information on the current and future magnitude, distribution, and the causes of malnutrition in populations for policy formulations, program planning, management, and evaluation. So here we generate all the information that is important regarding nutrition, and especially the causes and prevalence and magnitude of malnutrition in populations. And this is important for us to find out better policies and plan better programs in order to prevent malnutrition in the community. The concept of nutritional surveillance is derived from disease surveillance, and it also means to watch over nutrition in order to make decisions that lead to improvements in nutrition in populations. Nutrition surveillance systems vary significantly, and they will depend upon the context, the type of emergency, and the type of information that is required, and the frequency of reporting, the capacity of staff, and also other resources available. And in more stable contexts, nutrition surveillance utilizes a more stabilized set of data sources. For example, we have the globally practiced surveys, such as the Demographic and Health Survey, the DHS. But usually in nutrition surveillance, there is a generally lower frequency of reporting compared to disease surveillance. We have what we call active surveillance. During the emergency phase, when an emergency comes up immediately, some actions have to be taken. So this is what we call active surveillance. And this can be done in terms of food availability and accessibility assessments. You have to go around the communities and find out the actual amount and quality of food that reaches the families. You gather data at different levels of the food chain, and also information from distributing agencies and beneficiaries is gathered. We also have health and nutritional status surveillance. You carry out nutritional surveys repeatedly, and you monitor the trends of malnutrition and morbidity or outbreaks and mortality. You find out the case mortality rate for under 5, the rate of malnutrition. And then also feeding programs. You have to monitor the feeding centers. You find out whether the rations provided are enough, whether the program is effective, and then you have to carry out proper registration. Find out the proportion of recoveries and deaths, and this is going to help you gauge whether the program is being implemented rightly or not. Attendance rate, the coverage of the target group, and then the average weight gain in the targeted feeding programs. The monitoring program effectiveness. So this is very important in order to find out the effectiveness of the program. Active surveillance can also be done in the post-emergency phase. And here we have to still go ahead and find out in terms of food availability and accessibility through the general food distribution programs and other sources of food such as farming and income generating activities. You find out whether these services are being provided to the best or they are lacking in some areas. Then market availability and prices. Survey the prices of goods in the market and find out whether the local communities can afford these goods. If they cannot afford these goods, then what can be done in order so that they can be able to access these food services. Gather information from the refugees. They are the people on ground. They have the primary data. So they can tell you exactly what is on ground, which foods are available, what is not available, what are the problems that are affecting them. And they can even give you some solutions. Then household availability surveys can also be conducted. Here you go house to house and you find out in terms of food security and nutrition status and feeding, how are they coping with the situations. Here again, you have to go ahead and carry out health and nutritional status through nutrition surveys and malnutrition case finding. Then the food and nutritional situation of the local population. It's very important for you to find out the food and nutritional situation of all the people in the community. And the feeding programs available. Which ones are there and which ones can you add in order to make the program more efficient? Methods of nutritional surveillance. We have large-scale national surveys and these are carried out for almost all the population. We have a large number of people answering the questionnaires and they provide you with more accurate information in this case. And then we have repeated small-scale surveys. These are carried out continuously after a short period of time. Then clinic-based monitoring. You go ahead and find out information and monitor the effectiveness of the health systems. Sentinel site surveillance. Here, purposely selected communities or service delivery sites are chosen. And you have to detect the changes in the context, the program, and the outcome variables. Census data. Through a population census, you can be able to find out a lot of information concerning nutrition of the populations. Emergency surveys. Here we have the rapid assessments, the rapid screening, and the services statistics monitoring. Rapid assessments. These are mainly carried out on an ad hoc basis and are useful when nutrition information is urgently needed and when access to the population of concern is limited by time or by lack of other resources. So by ad hoc, we mean this is information that is needed immediately. That is why the assessments are carried out right at that moment, rapid. You carry out these surveys very quickly in order to determine the severity of the problem. And this can be done through anthropometric, dietary, and other data, which are collected during the rapid nutrition assessments. And these are usually undertaken with partners from the food security and the health sectors. They work together in order to gather this information, analyze it and come up with better solutions. An inventory of assessments is available and is summarized in the monthly nutrition updates. The rationale for carrying out these rapid assessments is one, you have to determine the prevalence of malnutrition. This is the main goal in terms of wasting, stunting and underweight among children aged 6 to 59 months and also measuring 65 to 110 centimeters. You need also to identify the key food security issues that are influencing the population. To determine the possible causes of malnutrition in the survey population and also to recommend a range of interventions most likely to be effective in order to improve the nutritional status of the survey population. The key parameters looked at here, we have the acute malnutrition of children, and this is defined by the ratio of weight for height and classified by severity using the World Health Organization criteria. Chronic malnutrition in children, this is defined by the ratio of height for age classified by severity using the World Health Organization criteria. And undernutrition in women is defined by the body mass index, which is the ratio of the weight out of the height in meters squared. Iron deficiency anemia in women and children, this is defined by hemoglobin determination and classified by severity using the World Health Organization criteria. You have to also focus on the key nutrient deficiencies of critical macronutrients in terms of energy and protein, malnutrition, and then micronutrients deficiencies such as iron, calcium, vitamins A and E, and folic acid. And this can be done by carrying out a 24-hour dietary recall on the youngest children in the household and their mothers. Rapid screening. Rapid nutrition assessments can be undertaken as part of the initial assessments in order to obtain an overview of the nutritional situation and also determine the areas and the population groups affected by an emergency. It's also very reasonable to recommend and implement nutrition interventions temporarily based on the rapid assessment results. And you have to note that rapid assessments should not be taken as a substitute for the standard nutrition assessments. While these rapid assessments are needed to be carried out immediately, the standard nutrition assessments that are continuous over time in a longitudinal basis should not be abandoned. The rapid assessment should not be a substitute for that. An appropriate intervention has also been identified, and a standard emergency nutrition assessment should be conducted simultaneously with implementation. Nutrition rapid assessments basically refer to the collection of a combination of quantitative and qualitative information on the immediate and underlying causes of malnutrition in terms of health, food security, water and sanitation, and also including the quantification of the outcome. The objectives here is to verify whether flagged areas of concern by the early warning system reports are actually hotspot areas. The early warning system is going to flag areas of concern, and once this nutrition surveillance and rapid assessment is carried out, you're going to be able to find out whether these areas are actually at risk or they are already facing this problem. At what level? What is the severity of the problem in this population? And then to assess whether there is a need for a standard emergency nutrition assessment, and to trigger an immediate response where acute needs are identified in specific areas or population groups. Implementation strategies. The criteria. The rapid nutrition assessments are triggered on the basis of secondary data, and here we mean the information generated by the early warning systems in terms of decline in food security or an unusual increase in mortality, an increased rate of malnutrition, a disease outbreak, or a displacement of people from reports by the UN agencies or NGOs and teams such as the interagency and interdisciplinary teams. So the team members who will be taking anthropometric measurements must have prior and extensive experience in measurement techniques and testing for edema. So these members have to be trained in order to carry out these different assessments and measurements. Some of the rapid assessment activities include key informant interviews, focus group discussions, transect walks, and anthropometric measurements of children of 0 to 59 months. Reporting and decision making. The data collected during the rapid assessment has to be summarized throughout the field visit. Also, preliminary data has to be presented at an oral debriefing session with the early warning systems committee. And the initial results of preliminary data are presented during the debriefing. Some of the rapid response strategies. As part of the initial debriefing, the joint agreements have to be made when life-saving interventions are deemed necessary And this is based on the results of the rapid assessment and the overall evaluation of the area assessed. If the capacity of the staff, the expertise to follow the national guidelines, the facilities and the supplies of the local facilities is overwhelmed by the high prevalence of acute malnutrition, and then capacity building of the existing facilities or interventions by the non-governmental agencies will be required for implementation. Consideration of other aggravating factors in the assessed area, such as health, food security, socioeconomic status, water and sanitation, have to be also put in place. Then we also have what we call service statistics monitoring. Service statistics refers to a type of monitoring metric that can be collected to improve health systems and services. And this is data often collected at health facilities, for example, at hospitals or clinics and health centers. Service statistics may include health service delivery data, such as the client volume, how many clients come to this health facility, referrals made from the community or completed, the services offered, the uptake of health products and services, and provider skills and behaviors. And service statistics are ideal when seeking to monitor an intervention or program that is embedded in the health system, whether in a hospital, in a clinic, or any other health system organization. Service statistics may also include experiences with the health system, such as staff-patient ratio. Are the staff overwhelmed by the number of patients coming in, or is there a few patients coming in and there are a lot of staff? The wait times, how long do our patients take waiting to be attended to? Client perceptions about the quality of patient-provider interactions, and also the cost of the healthcare services. And these statistics can be collected and analyzed using both primary data collection or analysis and secondary data analysis. The primary data collection analysis of service statistics can be done through surveys or interviews, such as exit interviews when the patient is being discharged. You carry out an interview to find out the quality of the services that have been offered, patient satisfaction, the length of time spent with the provider, and also the waiting time. Secondary data basically refers to the quantitative data collected through the existing health system infrastructures or records, such as identified patient records, client volume, referrals made and completed, the services offered, and also uptake of medication are some service statistics that can be collected and analyzed in the health centers. Approaches in assessing the community. It's very important to review the existing literature and the historical events and developments in that population before carrying out any survey. You have to make observations and carry out interviews. You can have unstructured interviews, there's no clear-cut distinctive guidance, and then semi-structured interviews with key informants, guided focus groups, and questionnaire-based household interviews. You can carry out broad surveys and controlled experimental studies in terms of community trials or quasi-experiments. The relevant nutritional status indicators. The percentage of wasting, stunting, underweight, overweight, and obesity, and then the percentage of severe acute and moderate malnutrition, the percentage of exclusive breastfeeding, the diet diversity scores and nutrient intake levels, the nutrient adequacy ratio, micronutrient deficiency levels, and the nutrition-related disease burden. These are some of the relevant nutrition status indicators, including food availability and access levels, and the intake of anti-nutritive factors and nutrient bioavailability, the methods of food storage, preparation and service, and also the adequacy of complementary feeding. So basically, these are some of the major aspects of nutrition surveillance in emergency settings. Thank you.